Steve Rinella is the host of Meat Eater. He has a podcast, really? TV show. It's on Netflix, and it's also on the Sportsman's Channel. I don't know if it's
No, it's not. He's a Netflix original now.
Well, that season is, but I don't know about the old season still being on there. But regardless, before that, he had a show on the Travel Channel called Wild Within.
Really?
And that was, yeah, it was, I think it ran like 7 or 8 episodes or something like
eight.
That. Could be 8. Mm-hmm. And then from there, they canceled it, and then he went out and created his own brand, mm-hmm. Meat Eater brand, and then co-produced it with a company called 0.0 Productions out of New York. They're a very big production company, super high-quality company. They make a lot of shows, and Meat Eater is one of them. They co-produce it together, and I'm going to talk about the business side of things because it's something that a lot of people don't understand, and I think a lot of people are curious about. So in this, I don't know the exact finances, and I don't know the exact numbers. I'm not going to act like I do because I wasn't part of that deal, but
nice.
The way it works is, in those situations, is when you co-produce something, ownership is split between the two, the production company and the personality slash business owner slash brand owner. So Steve Rinella owns the brand of Meat Eater, and he took that to 0.0 Productions, who now likely owns a piece of it. And the reason why somebody would do that is because 0.0 Productions can invest a bunch of money into it, get it, you know, negotiate the networks, the sponsors, stuff like that, whereas Steve can focus on a lot of the production side. Now, some of those roles and stuff, again, because I'm not, you know, involved in that specific deal, but those roles and stuff can kind of be blended where Steve might do more of this and more of that and less of this and less of that, given the exact circumstances. Now, as companies grow and get a lot of eyes, big producers and bigger production companies are liable to take an interest in it because they can be pretty profitable. Right now, Netflix, Hulu, all these companies are buying up content. Well, as they're buying up content and content's becoming more valuable, you're getting different people coming into the game that care about money and care about production. So Peter Chernin, his first name's Peter, right, I believe?
Yeah. Sounds
Chernin right. Is the name. He's a big-time producer. He came in and I don't know if he purchased part of 0.0 or I don't know if he just invested in the Meat Eater brand, but I do know that the deal was sealed with Steve Rinella regaining full production control over the content of the show. So Steve Rinella is still maintaining that. So what happened was they invested, and it's kind of a money investment. Now, Chernin is known as a very large Democrat, and he invests a lot of money into Democratic candidates. And Steve Rinella has actually had Democratic candidates and different people on his podcast before. Now, here's the thing about the outdoor industry. There's people on the Democrat side, and there's people on the Republican side that share the same goals of conservation, protecting state land, protecting federal lands, protecting species and stuff like that. It's not if you're on the Republican side or the Democrat side, one way or the other.
There's not really teams.
No, there's not. There's not. And there's policies that fall one way or the other a lot of times. But yeah. The big one that sticks out in the hunting and fishing community, especially the viewers of Meat Eater as well as other shows, is the Second Amendment and the gun laws and stuff like that. Because obviously, if you're hunting and fishing, you're using guns most likely. And
I hope if you're fishing, you're not using guns.
Okay, Ryan, I'm sorry.
So, you can use a bow.
Is that a gun?
We are not going to digress in this. I'm staying focused. So the idea is with the Second Amendment being attacked a lot by the Democratic side, there's a lot of people that watch Meat Eater and a lot of the base and a lot of the people that write articles about hunting and fishing and stuff like that that are very, very defensive over the Second Amendment, as am I, but as is Steve. Steve Rinella is very protective over the Second Amendment as well. So there was articles written and a big attack and kind of like a campaign against Steve Rinella, which is weird because he's like our older brother, even though we've never met him and he's never talked to us. Yeah. But to me, he's like our older brother because he's like the one who...
We look up to him very... Like, we don't know him at all, but we look up to him quite...
And I also understand the industry, whereas the person who wrote the articles did not. They don't understand the industry, so they don't even understand what the deal did. So people were upset because Chernin... put a bunch of money into this program. Let's be honest, Trinan's there for a reason. He wants to make money, right? So he can put money into liberal, you know, candidates and stuff like that and do his own thing. But Steve holds production control. And Steve is a big supporter of the NRA. Or not the NRA, excuse me. I don't know whether he is or not of the NRA. He's a big proponent for the Second Amendment. And he does a lot for the Second Amendment. Just by having a hunting and fishing show and kind of decriminalizing hunting in general, he naturally does a lot for the Second Amendment. He's never talked about adding regulations to guns or anything like that. He doesn't say anything like that. He never has. I can guarantee he probably never will.
He does a pretty good job of not being political.
Yeah.
Can be hard.
It is. It is tough.
So many people attack.
And I slip a lot with the political stuff, and I try not to. I try not to because I don't want to. I don't – right now – at this phase of my life and with the Green Bay Outdoors, I don't want to be involved in politics right now.
There you go.
So my goal is to further conservation, and whatever side of the aisle and whoever I have to talk to on both sides to do that, I will. See, because if there's a – right now we have a Democrat governor now, okay? And if I can meet with them and I can talk to them and help further conservation, why on earth would I not do that? If Steve Rinella can get an investment and a partnership with Chernin, who's a big-time producer who can make things happen, then, and he gets to hold creative content and further his mission, why wouldn't he? But it brings up the point that I want to make is that we get a lot of emails every time our show airs. We get a lot of messages. We get a lot of different contacts from people. And I will say this. We are attacked more from hunters and fishermen and the right, by far, than we are from the left.
Yeah.
From the vegans and anti-hunters and stuff like that.
it's always the vegans.
Yeah. From people that would possibly oppose us. I'm not saying all vegans oppose us and this and that. What I'm saying is there's sides.
Mm-hmm.
And
In that sense.
And it's not just one side. It's like eight different sides that I mentioned. But we get attacked from the ones that fall on the right column a whole lot more than anyone else, because they're always the police, like the bear episode.
Oh,
aired.
My gosh.
And I got all these messages.
Got a thing to say.
I've got all these messages and emails of people complaining because they're like, hey, you didn't have your appropriate Hunter Orange on. It's like, well, first of all, it was the late season, which I said 11 times in the show.
Mm-hmm.
There's no deer hunting season going on at that point. Therefore, I did not have to wear Hunter Orange. Copy and paste the DNR law and send. And then I had to send that over and over and over again to all these people that are like, you broke the law. No, I didn't. Here it is. It's like, because they
people love to, like, the gotcha.
Yeah.
They're all
And to be fair, though, there was a couple people that would reach out and be like, hey, I love your show. I really like you. I don't want you to get dinged for something. It ain't my ting. I don't want you to get tinged for something. I see that you didn't have orange on. You might have been breaking the law. And then I replied a little bit nicer to them. But it's like, it's so annoying, you know, people. So we get stuff like that, or, your gun this, or it's the stupidest stuff.
You were aiming your gun at. No, I wasn't.
You can see that I was. I mean, just the dumb stuff that we get is always, to be honest with you, from the right. Like, we get it from the right a lot, bad messages like this and attacked. And I think Steve, because he's bigger and at the higher level, he's receives a lot more from the left, typically, because of his stance, you know, because he's so mainstream, which we will get to.
So what was the drama, though?
The big drama was he took money from Chernin, who's a big Democrat.
That's why they're mad?
Well, keep in mind, though, he's put a bunch of money towards politicians that were very anti-Second Amendment and stuff like that.
Who cares?
So because of that, though, his influence on Meteor, like Steve, sold out. When he didn't, he retained creative control, so he didn't sell out. But they're like, he sold out. It's going to ruin that show. It's going to ruin the content. And now one of the good guys has gone to the bad side. And it's like, no, he didn't.
Oh, my God.
But
there's not a bad side. People just have different views.
That makes me so mad, ridiculous thing.
We're right and you're wrong, and there's no good about whatever
there's,
you
there's no listening to what the other.
So because he partnered with someone that gives money to Democrats or whatever, the idiots on the other
side,
not that the other side they're idiots, but the idiots because they're complaining.
By the way, Chernin, I believe, owns a stake in Fox. I mean, he doesn't care about, like, he does that for the money and stuff. He can put his money wherever he wants. I may disagree with where Chernin puts his money, but you mean to tell me we're negotiating with all these different agents and stuff like that? How many of them do you think are going to be right-wingers? None? I mean, you have to be able to communicate with people that don't share every one of your views and be able to meet in the middle. And when it comes to conservation, when it comes to hunting and fishing, those are very in the middle things. You've got people from the left that are right, you got people from the right that are right, and you've got people on the left that are wrong, and you've got people on the right that are wrong when it comes to conservation and public lands and stuff like that.
Yeah.
And
I'm sure that Steve doesn't even care that people are upset. He's like, whatever. Like,
actually,
this one
kind of bothered him.
Really, he responded to it.
He did. Oh, okay. I've never seen him respond to to trash talk before.
Okay.
Except for a couple times in podcasts.
Well, he was on some pretty mainstream news outlets saying some
this
stuff.
This went big. This was a viral thing.
Yeah, and they, like, some of the evidence they used, like, he got interviewed and some, like, they were, the reporter was asking him about ARs, and he didn't really comment on it. He didn't talk down about it.
He said that he doesn't hunt with an AR.
Yeah.
All he said.
And he said that he doesn't hunt with people who use ARs either.
Right.
And
because none of his friends do. And neither do mine.
And they twisted it to make it seem like, I don't hunt with you because you use an AR, when really it is, how many times have you gone out hunting with an AR?
I've never. I take that back. We did do it pig hunting and coyoting 2 times in my whole life.
Right. Which is a very small amount of time that you've spent hunting.
Yeah.
So it's just not, that's not a gun you.
Most people don't, right? You might use it for pig and you might use it for coyote. Everyone's got their applicable things, but Steve's a big game hunter. He barely goes after those things.
You always see him carrying.
It doesn't matter. A single shot rifle. My dad uses a gun from like the 1800s. That's right. Does that mean he's not a proponent for the Second Amendment? I mean, that's the dumbest thing I've ever heard.
Yeah.
So to be clear, Steve did leave a message.
Oh, yeah.
He did respond to this saying, like, you could tell, too, he's, like, a little heated the way it was recorded. But I kind of felt, if we can come to his aid and, you know, for our listeners and the people that tune into our show, if we can have his back a little bit, it's like, listen, you got to be able to talk to both sides here, the Democrats and the Republicans, to further conservation and hunting and fishing. Like, if that's your main goal, he's in that. And he's a big proponent for the Second Amendment.
Oh,
so attacking him because, like, we want to mob ourselves for some reason.
I'm confident that it's more in the outdoor industry than anywhere else.
It's insane. Yeah. I mean, we get attacked every
day. It's unbelievable. I don't understand why everyone's an expert.
They don't even know how bad Jeffrey smells. Why do they attack us so much?
Why do you insist on that?
I don't
know. People are going to think I smell.
I think the more...
I smell very nice. I got several comments today. Right?
You actually did smell good today.
Yeah.
I think the moral of the story is take 2 seconds just to shut your mouth and listen.
Your voice doesn't always have to be heard.
I want to call out one person that... Oh, no, I'm off the website already.
We'll wait.
You have to read 3 hours about something before you're allowed to comment. Or, you know, like...
Yeah.
That baffles me.
Yeah, I can't find it. But the guy that wrote the article was like... It was so long, I didn't read the whole thing because I ended up getting bored. The one where he was trashing him? Possibly. It's the one your brother sent me. I only know about this because your brother sent it to me.
Well, this one's on the Federalist.
It is that one.
Sean Davis.
Sean Davis. So Sean Davis took the time to write like 10,000 words on this whole thing.
It is very long.
And he's wrong. Like, he's wrong for the way he did it.
Like you said, he doesn't know the industry.
Well, it's like cooking up a story that's not existing, you know?
Wow.
I don't really like that.
That's most of the news now.
And as a big news person, like, as a journalist, it's your job to, like, know the whole backstory. Like, one call to Steve. Mm-hmm. One call to 0.0 Productions. One call to the Churning Group.
Yep.
One call, and you would have got the other side of the story. It didn't have to be this way, but he cooked it up. And look, we're talking about him. I said his name. He won.
I guess
he won.
That's bad. You know? That's just-